from University City, Missouri. I've been coming to MABA since I think 2006. And I originally became interested in meditation because it was something different and it was supposed to be good for you. But I didn't actually start meditating then. I started with mindfulness first. I did that for several years. And in 1994, I think I started meditating for the first time. And I started just generally reading about Buddhism, finding out general things about Buddhism. I had started meditating because I had a lot of anxiety issues and problems with fear. And meditation helped me so much immediately, just in the first few weeks that I did it, that I had to know more about Buddhism. That was why I started reading about Buddhism. Rather than just being interested in meditation or mindfulness that could help me, I had to know more about where they came from. And one of the things that kept me from coming to a center at that time was that when I meditated, I realized that the way I had thought about myself and the way I had looked at the world was maybe not right, that it might not be right, that I might have been looking at myself and at things around me in a way that was not the way they really were. So I kept learning about Buddhism just by reading about it, kept meditating for many years. And then about the time my daughter was three, I guess, when she 2006, I decided I was ready for a teacher, because I realized before I had been afraid that things were different than I had thought, and after those years of meditating, I knew they were different than I had thought. I was certain that things were different than what I had thought. I had a very empirical view of the world. I was agnostic, very scientific in my approach. And meditating helped me to see that I was not this solid, firm self that I had thought I was. That was what had frightened me about it when I first started meditating. And then after years of doing that, I knew that that was true. And so I thought, I need to explore this further now that I know for sure. So I started looking for teachers. And I settled on two. The first time I came to MABA, I just fell in love with the place. It has such a peaceful feel to it. Everything's very calm and peaceful. And the monastics were also very calm people. And everyone here was very nice. And so I decided I needed to study here, and I also began studying with a Tibetan teacher whom I study with online. So I've been doing both those things since about 2006-2007. Mindfulness is paying attention to what you do all the time. So the way I learned it was, you start off with something simple like washing the dishes or sweeping the floor, and just try to pay full attention to what you're doing. So when I did this, I found it just sort of opened the world up to me, because I saw the interaction I had with things and my impact on the world and the impact of the world on me. So that when I was washing the dishes, for instance, I wasn't just in a hurry to get done and wash the dishes. I saw the water coming from the faucet. I knew that the water came from somewhere else. It came from some river, and then it went down the drain. It didn't just disappear. It was going back to some other river somewhere and would be exposed to someone else. So I already was involved in a lot of different environmental organizations, and this mindfulness really made me very firm in my commitment to that. It made me really realize that we are interdependent with the rest of the world and interconnected with it in ways that we just don't notice if we're going through our lives sort of blindly and mindlessly. We don't notice that, you know, that dirty water that goes down the sink is going to be in someone else's faucet, maybe in a few weeks or a few months. So it makes you much more aware of what you are doing and how you're interacting with other people. And you also start to notice what you're doing with your body, how you're interacting with other people, physically, You start paying more attention to your speech and to just everything that you do. Okay. Meditation, I had a lot of benefit from mindfulness, but I still had my anxiety problems. Mm. So I kept reading that meditation was good for that. So I read one book, I think by Jon Kabat-Zinn. I read the first chapter and it explained shamatha very briefly. Mm-hmm. And so I read that and I started meditating. I've had some health problems over the years, and I have asthma, so I tend to get bronchitis whenever I have the flu or something. So I might end up being in bed for a few weeks, maybe not able to sit up, you know, periodically. And there was a time when I was in the hospital a couple of years ago when I couldn't move at all. I had to just lay flat on my back. And so, yeah, I've meditated in all positions probably, standing, sitting. And even like when I was in the hospital, when you lay down, you're supposed to be on your side and there's a specific position you take, but you know, you can't always do that sometimes. I had to lay on my back, so I meditated that way. Right? It's not just sitting, it's the way you are and the way you are paying attention to yourself. You're always doing something, right? And you're either doing it mindlessly or you're doing it mindfully. Mm. So you can sit mindfully as a meditation, you can walk mindfully, you can wash the dishes mindfully, you can sweep the floor mindfully, you can walk down the street mindfully. And when you are mindful like that, you don't just walk by strangers and ignore them as if they're not there, because you're mindful of what's going on all around you when you've developed that mindfulness. I had lots of trouble with anxiety. I was afraid of edges of things, which was related to falling down a steep slope when I was young, and driving a car, and even just interacting with people. Like I mentioned, I was a writer, so that when you submit your work, somebody has to look at it. And I developed so much anxiety about that I was having trouble sending work off. And just getting out even to drive somewhere, I would worry. So I could see everywhere that everything could go wrong, and there are so many ways things could go wrong. And that was what took over my mind, and I was kind of trapped in that. I guess I always had some nervousness, you know, but I don't know, in my 20s it just got worse and worse. It was like I was letting it take over. So I was able to stop it. Well, I found it very easy to sit and meditate, and I started off with, you know, 5 minutes a day the first week, and 10 minutes a day, and then 15 minutes. And that just sitting and paying attention to my breath, I found it completely calming. And I guess I was able to realize the breath just comes and goes. You don't have to do anything to it. You don't have to worry about what's going to happen. You can just be present, and things will happen as they're going to happen. Worrying is not going to make a difference. Mm. You know, things will be bad. If you worry, it doesn't matter. They'll be bad anyway. If they're going to be good, worrying didn't help either. So why worry? Because it doesn't do any good. And I just was able to get over it pretty quickly, really. It's like I snapped something in my mind so that I looked at the world differently. You can get out of your being wrapped up in yourself and your own stories and just be present with your child or with anybody and see them for who they are, where they are, and deal with that instead of thinking, oh, I need to train my child to do this, I need to train my child to do that. You know that the main point is to help them to be the person they are, to be a good person, and to be able to achieve whatever it is they can achieve in this life, and not be worried about, you know, your own hang-ups about what you think they should be doing or that you should be doing. So I think it has helped a lot. It also helps you to stay calmer. Was that 4 or 5 years ago? They started a teaching program, and Master G asked me to join. So that was a 2-year program we went through. We studied Buddhism and history of Buddhism and the schools, And we started teaching, mm-hmm. and gave some practice talks just within the class, and then started doing the Dharma talks on Sundays. Mm-hmm. And then just recently, I found out I was now a senior teacher rather than a teacher in training. Well, I would never have thought it was something I would want to do because I didn't think I could possibly know enough. You know, the more you learn about it, the more you know how much you don't know. So I don't know that I would have done it except Master G asked me to. And he said, when something has been given to you, you give it to someone else as well. So I view the Dharma teachings I've received as a gift, and I don't keep it. It's not mine, it's just something to pass on to other people. Mm-hmm. And teaching has certainly helped me learn a lot more because I have to prepare things for other people. I have to make sure I understand it really thoroughly because I'm not going to be able to explain it to other people. If I can't explain it in a simple way, I know I haven't understood it. So mm-hmm. I have to study it pretty intensively myself before mm-hmm. I can teach it to somebody else. It's everything the way it is. Mm-hmm. And it is being present with everything the way it is. It is not hiding, not running away, not putting up a fight, but being with the world the way it really is. And then all the teachings that the Buddha has given us about that, and that all the other teachers have given us about that, as they help us to understand what the Buddha said. That's also the Dhamma. Okay. Buddha was a person. He was born into a very wealthy family, a royal family. And he led a very nice life, but he realized that there were bad things in the world, that people suffered. And so he thought he had to do something about that, especially when he had, I think it's interesting to me that the point he left home, it was after his child had been born. So it talks about the last night before he left, he stood there looking at his wife and his baby laying there, and he left. So for me, I think he really left because he realized with the suffering in the world, everybody suffering, the best thing I can do for my wife and for my little son is to go out and figure out this suffering and how to stop it. So he did that. He studied for a long time. He looked for answers, and he finally found them himself and taught them to other people because he wanted to help others not suffer. Well, the main thing that he discovered, he studied meditation, he apparently did a lot of yoga practice, he sat, he practiced asceticism, tried to eat as little as possible, to sit all the time. He did all these practices that other people were doing, and he realized that wasn't giving him the answer. So he decided he was going to sit under a tree until he figured it out. And he realized that everything came down to interdependent origination, that nothing is separate, nothing is alone, everything is interconnected. Our bodies are just pieces that will fall apart someday. Our self is just something we have put together that doesn't really exist. And all his teachings are built upon that, the interdependent origination. Mm-hmm. You can draw from that emptiness, compassion, because if it's not mine, if it's not yours, if we're just sharing, we're all the same, then why should I keep anything just for me? Mm-hmm. We can both have it. We mm-hmm. can share. When you realize that people are the same as you, that they're not wholly different entities, that they're just like you, then you can have empathy for whatever they're going through because you know you could go through it too. Mm-hmm. And from that you have compassion. Mm-hmm. So all of his teachings come down to interdependent origination. The Four Noble Truths, that everything, you can build it up from interdependent origination. Mm-hmm. helps you to come back to what's going on right now instead of getting caught up in our stories. The world is full of stories, you know. Our phones will tell us stories, the TV's telling us stories, the guys with the cameras are telling us stories. There are all these stories that we can get wrapped up in, and we get lost in those instead of being present with what we need to be dealing with right now. Mm-hmm. So if we can stay present with that, to let go of all these stories, because the stories often build up anxiety. You know, we worry, this could happen, that could happen. Oh, and if that happens, then this will happen, and then everything is bad. So they can help us to stay present and not get lost in worry. Well, more even than just telling her things, I have tried to give her tools she can use herself, so that she can deal with things herself, because she'll ultimately have to deal with them herself, like we all do. So I've tried to show mindfulness. I did teach her to sit and watch her breath when she was upset. If they can get these techniques and you can remind them of them when they're going through something difficult, they can use them to calm down, stay present, and if you can stay calm, you can figure out what the truth is in all the stories that you're hearing, because you'll be more clear-minded. MABA's role is to make the Dharma available in the Midwest, to have a permanent home where Dharma teachings can be found and where you can learn to practice. So we have meditation trainings if you want to do that. If you want to learn more about Buddhism, we can also help with that. So I think whatever level you are at when you come here, wherever you are when you come here, we can probably meet you there and help you out some way or another.
MABA is like a survival camp.
Yes. It's like triage for living in the world out there with all the craziness. I hope so. Whenever someone comes and says something like it was a big help or that I helped them, I'm so glad, because I've been helped so much and I want others to get helped the same way. This isn't just something that's, you know, for me, for one person. It's for everybody, anybody who would like to find it and use it. So it's gratifying to know that I didn't stop it with me. I can hand it on to other people and help them out, hopefully. The monastics came from other countries. Master Ji came from Malaysia, and Venerable Kungshi and her sister Kong Wan also, and there have been other monastics who've come and gone over the years. They were asked to come to teach here because there was no master here to teach to the Chinese community that was here already, mainly Chinese, but also people from other backgrounds, Vietnamese and other countries. And they wanted someone who could teach. Mr. G came to teach, but he also wants to establish this as a center that's not just going to be here and gone, that it'll be here permanently, mm-hmm. so that people can keep coming here. And Dharma will be available from now on here. That is the new building. It's lovely inside. It's expanded from the farmhouse that was here originally. The materials are predominantly local, and it's just really beautiful inside. We have more rooms for women to come say. It's the female residence house. There's going to be a new library in there, and we have a hall, which looks like it will be really beautiful. We're going to have some new statues also, and we have a new meditation hall upstairs. So it's a really lovely building.
Okay.
And it will allow us to teach more people and have longer retreats. It's nice to come just to spend the day here. It's peaceful. It's a fun drive if you like to drive. It's very beautiful here. You can learn about another religion, maybe another culture. see how other people are dealing with life, and then you can go home if you like. You don't have to come back. You can just come here and enjoy it and go away, or you can keep coming back. We have free lunch. Very good lunch, yeah. We can explain to you how to sit and meditate if you would like to know more about that. And we have Dharma talks every Sunday. Study groups also at different levels of practice. For beginners, we're just starting the Dhammapada study group, which is a really beautiful text from the Buddha. It's in poem. And I think that's accessible for anybody.
Very good. Yeah. Very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.